even if it's just a simple phone call, amen, to tell her, you know, or whatever, or a card, amen, just to let them know, you know, a flower or something, you know what I mean, just to let her know that she has family here, amen, and, you know, I believe that's when the church really rises up, is in the death and in grief and in sorrow. That's when I think the church should rise up. You know what I mean? Not just the pastors, you know what I mean? But the church, you know, to surround and to extend your love and your faith. And even if it's just a prayer, amen, for their family, amen. But thank you, Jesus. We're going to talk tonight, and I'm going to title this, God Will Reverse the Curse. God will reverse the curse. I was trying to think of how to say, turn around, and turn around. I think it was turn around that we were singing about, or never go back. And I was thinking, is it volver? Uh-huh. Volver is, like, is it turn around?
Volver is to go back.
Volver is to go back. And I was thinking, I never want to go back to my old life.
Nunca quiero volver.
Nunca quiero volver a mi vida. Amen. Never want to go back. Amen. I'm trying to learn Spanish. Amen. I'm trying to learn as much as I can. You never know when you're going to have to preach.
Right. Amen.
I know, you know what I mean, that we have had that lady come and her husband come. And so, you know what I mean, just, you know, some of you don't wonder what your gift and talent and all this is. You know what I mean? And sometimes it's just being able to let God use you, especially in the area of reaching out to Spanish people. Amen. Because they need the Lord, you know what I mean? And they're going to, it blows my mind, going to Jehovah's Witness and church and all this, and to see literally thousands of them fill the state fair for their Jehovah's Witness, you know, thing in the summertime. And it just, that grieves my heart to see so many Spanish-speaking people serving a false God. You know what I mean? And somebody's got to raise up and preach the gospel. But I can't do everything. You with me?
Amen.
I can't do it all. And I need, you know, people to rise up and to, oh, like, because God will open the doors for you if you just let Him. If you with me? If you just let Him use you, God will open the doors for you to reach people, speak to people, pray for people. That's the way our ministry started. Amen. Actually, you know, Jen, I'm glad you sat down. Come on. I want you to come up here and I want you to share your testimony real quick that you shared with me that day. Come here. She's like, what are you doing, Pastor? Sister Jen prayed for somebody the other day, for a man, right? A guy. I want you to just quickly share with them about that story, okay?
Most of you know that I do home health care. But one of the ladies I take care of, she had an appointment at her doctor's office at Parkview. And so we went over there, and it was in the building where the parking garage is, and she has a hard time walking in that. So, you know, I park in the front, take her inside, sit her down, and then call for a wheelchair, and then I go and park the car, and then go and, you know, go back inside, and then hopefully they have the wheelchair there yet. So we got there and still nothing, and then this man happens to come in, and he was sitting with his wife, and there was just something about him when I first seen him. And then he sat down next to my little lady Shannon, and I went to the next floor to see if I could find a wheelchair, because we still hadn't gotten one yet. And so his wife, she went to go park her car, and she had left him sitting there with my lady Shannon. And then I came back and he was still there, and all of a sudden I just felt like this, you know, and I know it was the Holy Spirit just saying, you know, pray for him. Because he was in there and he was telling a story to my lady and telling her, because she was asking him, oh, are you okay? What would happen? Because he, you know, he had on his breathing thing and that, and he was telling her, yeah, he goes, you wouldn't believe it, but a few months ago, he's all, I was working, I was getting around, I was doing this and that. And he said that him and his wife had went on vacation somewhere. I missed a part of the beginning of the story, he said. And then he goes, and then he got some kind of an airborne illness, a really bad illness. And it just like almost crippled him. He ended up in the hospital. He started having all these problems. And then he ended up getting like, I guess, cancer on his nose. And you could tell, you know, he was having problems with his nose. But, you know, he was still trying to keep going and that. And so they were just in there talking about it. And I just felt like I started wanting to shake. And I know it was the Holy Spirit. And he said, just pray for him. So I just walked up to him. He didn't even really know me. He was talking more to my little lady. I just asked him, you know what, sir? And he just looked at me wide-eyed. And, you know, I asked him, can I pray for you? And he's like, you know, sure. So we're right there in, you know, the bottom of the park, you know, Parkview right there. People are coming in and out all the time. And so I just grabbed his hand. And even my little lady, she knows when I pray, you know, she's just like, okay. And she just was in it with me too. So she's behind me and she's praying there too. And I just was praying for him. And I just feel the Holy Spirit just all over us. And I just began, you know, to weep and pray for this man, pray for his healing, and pray for his body, for his family, and all I can see the whole time I was praying is just him being healed and his family being healed and them giving their lives to God and, you know, just the glory. And he was just sat there and he's just looking at me like, I don't, you know, like he just, you know, something just happened, but he just didn't know, you know, what. So he's just like, okay. And I know there's people walking around and getting at the elevator, and I'm just here, you know, they're probably just listening to me, but I didn't care. So we walked up, and my little lady, she's just like, oh my gosh, I could just feel the Holy Spirit all over. And I'm just like, I know. And I just told them, you know, God's going to heal him. God's healing him and what God's going to do in his life. And I was just so excited inside because, you know, God revealed that part to me. You know, sometimes we pray for them, but we don't really see. But I got a glimpse into the outcome, and I always think about him. And I just say, at first, I know it was the devil that was trying to say, you didn't do nothing for him. You ain't doing that. All of a sudden, I started feeling that. And I'm like, no, you know, God wouldn't lie. No, God's going to heal him. He's going to heal him, and that's it. And I even right now, I could just see him, you know, happy somewhere, being healed. And, you know, him giving the glory to God, that God cared enough and loved him enough to, you know, to pray for him just right there. So that just made me even more. So me and Diego have just been on this thing. We've made him, you know, my son just praying for people and anointing them with the oil. And it's awesome. And then I have another testimony because my cousin Jessica, she's had a real hard time, you know, getting pregnant and that and stuff. And you know, she does really well for herself. And I've really, over the years, you know, I've really, you know, I know God's touching her and, you know, is bringing her into his kingdom. I know that, you know, she's going to be saved, and God willingly, she's going to be coming to church with me. But a few months ago, before I left for Christmas vacation, me and her had prayed. And she was just talking about how she really wanted to have a baby. And I told her, well, let's pray, Jessica. I said, what do you got to do? Let's talk to God. Me and you will go on to pray, and we'll ask him. And she's like, okay, and we prayed. And then I just got the news last week that she said that she is pregnant. So she's so happy, and I'm so happy for her. So I'm just so grateful. And I told her, see, Jessica? And just the other day, me and Diego went over there to go visit her because we hadn't had time to see each other. And she had said the girls had been sick, and they had been sick. So I said, okay, Diego, let's go. We went and got our anointing oil, and I said, we're going to go pray for the girls. He's like, okay. So even my cousin Jessica, she's like, all right, let's pray. So she sat down with me and her girls, and me and Diego anointed them, and we prayed for them, and they've been doing so good, and I'm so proud of them. And I know these little girls are going to serve the Lord one day, too. I'm praying. I know he is. So thank you, Zara. Thank you.
Amen. We dedicated him to the Lord.
Yeah, amen.
Thank you, Jesus. God answers prayer. Amen.
Amen.
God wants to use you to be somebody's blessing.
Amen.
With me, a lot of times, you know, the devil beats you down, tells you what you ain't, and all this bad stuff. And we go around, and really, we believe this.
Amen.
You know, and what you need to do is believe the Word of God and what it says. And God, not only does he want to bless you and reverse the curse in your life, but he wants to reverse a curse in their life, and he's going to use you to do it.
Amen.
And so that's what we're going to talk about tonight. God will reverse the curse. Numbers chapter 21, verse 4 through 9, if you would turn there. If you want to follow along. If not, you could just mark it down. Numbers 21, verses 4 through 9. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Let me pray while you're turning there. Father, thank you tonight for the Word of God. Thank you for each and everyone that's here. Thank you for those that are viewing this by YouTube. Father, tonight we pray, Lord God, that you would not only teach us, but anoint us Send us out there, Lord, as the very hands and feet of God, the very voice of the Lord, Father, to bless your bless those who are being oppressed of the enemy or bombarded by the enemy. Father, Lord God, just reverse the curse, God, tonight. Father, Lord God, that's why you sent your Son. And Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that this word would get inside of us. And Father, Lord God, that we would believe it tonight, God. Father, you've anointed us for such a time as this, in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen and amen. Numbers 21, verse 4 through 9. You there?
Amen.
Then they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea. It says that to go around the land of Edom, and then the souls of the people. Now watch this, okay? They come out of Egypt. They're out of bondage. They're out of slavery. They're going by the Red Sea. Now, you know. Let's just say, for instance, they got saved and were serving the Lord. But then it comes a time in your life where you start to get discouraged. Discouragement, you with me? Will pull you away from God.
Right.
You with
Amen.
Me? Discouragement is not seeing those things you prayed for come to pass.
Yeah.
You with me? And so you start to get down and weary, and that's exactly when the enemy attacks you. It's like he attacks your immune system, if you would, with the flu or something when you're weak and when you're down, and that's exactly what discouragement does. It will let the enemy in. You with me? It said that they, now watch, it says to go around the land of Edom, it says, and the souls of the people became very discouraged on the way. Amen? You know what in the book of Acts, what's called the way? It's a movement. It's serving Jesus. It's living for God. It's called the way. On the way, these people got discouraged. And a lot of times you're going to see, the Old Testament is like a shadow or of the New Testament. What happened physically there happened spiritually here in the New Testament, which we're living in. You with me? And so this is what happened to them. They got discouraged along the way, just like you're serving the Lord. And it's so easy to get discouraged. It's so easy because you deal with situations and hardships and relationships and sickness and money problems and all that. You know, that's why it's important is go to church and get in there and hear the word. Sometimes you could read and pray, but it's nothing like going to church and hearing the worship and getting involved and hearing Pastor preaching or Pastor Susan preaching or whoever it is. You know what I mean? And it just kind of lifts you up and gives you strength to go on.
Amen.
Amen. Matt, do me a favor, brother. Shut this window here, please. Let's see, where am I at? And the people spoke. Now listen, they got discouraged along the way, and it's important when you get discouraged, you're watching what your mouth is saying. Amen. It says, and the people spoke against God and against their pastor Moses. When they were discouraged, when in their Christian life, they started speaking bad things. And listen, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? This is what they started saying. You with me? Why do we even, they keep telling us that if we give our money, that God's going to provide, and that it's a lie because I'm broke all the time and this and that. Well, don't check your finances and check your little book, your checkbook, and see where your spending is. Don't blame us that you paid your tithes. Where's the other 90 going, and how are you spending that? You with me? How are you financially, handling your situation? Don't blame because you put 10 bucks in the offering and it's our fault and now you're broke and all this stuff. Come on, man. You didn't say that about Sonics. Huh? Spent $25 on malts for everyone and all this. You never called Sonic up and said, hey, I want to talk to the owner. My $25 and now I'm broke because I had a craving for some chocolate, a shake. When they got discouraged, they started opening their mouth, amen, and they said, why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and our soul loathes this worthless bread, which was the manna from heaven, we can't stand that bread. That's what they were saying. We hate the bread God gave us. It's gross. There's not even no ketchup, nothing. No butter. This ain't like the Texas Roadhouse butter and all that stuff. One time we went just a few weeks ago. Al ate all the bread. She didn't even share it. She had all the bread down there at the end. And she had all the butter and everything. I looked at Val and she just buttered. She's selfish. I hate this bread that they were saying. Amen. There's no food and there's no water here. Amen. And sometimes when we're going through hard times, we start saying stuff we shouldn't say. And watch, there's consequences for it. That's why God's telling us, don't say stuff out of your mouth you shouldn't say, because something's going to bite you in the... You know what? And watch what happens. It says that they hate the worthless bread. So the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. Remember today I was telling you, you don't think God gets mad at us? You with me? You don't think we can just live however we want and there's no consequences for it? It's not true. That serpent, that devil, he's out there. And he'll bite you. It says that the Lord sent these fiery serpents, amen, to the people of Israel, and many of the people of Israel died. Therefore, the people, now when things started to happen, then the people came to their pastor. And they said, we have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray for us. Or pray that the Lord, pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. Amen. Have I ever told you that? Ever? Have you ever heard me say, be careful who you talk about, especially your pastors, because it's us that are going to be doing your funeral. It's us that will be visiting you in the ICU. It's us that will be there when a lot of people won't be there. Or maybe they even though they come around, they're not going to know what to do. You with me? Amen. And so these people were talking against Moses, had to go to Moses, had to humble themselves and come and say, hey, listen, we're being bitten by all this stuff. And you know what? You know who caused it? We did. We sinned against God. We messed up. We complained. We weren't satisfied with the little that we had. And we started talking about God himself and about you. And they had to go to Moses and ask him, would you pray for us, Moses? Amen. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. So Moses prayed for the people. Amen? That's what your pastors will do no matter what you do or say about us. We'll pray for you. You with me? Moses prayed for these people. Then the Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole. And in other words, a bronze serpent, set it on. Of all things he used, the very things that were biting him, he put on a pole. You with me? Yeah. He put a snake on that pole, and he lifted that pole up high. Amen? Yeah. The Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it shall be everyone, now watch this, everyone who is bitten, when he looks at the bronze serpent, shall live. So Moses made a bronze serpent, and he put it on a pole. And so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, that when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. Numbers 21, verse 4 through 9. You with me? Wow. Now check this out. I bet you never seen this. John chapter 3. You know John 3:16, right? Yeah. But look at the two verses before it. John 3:14 said, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man, which is Jesus, be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Amen? Amen. And so when these people sinned, these people did wrong, these people complained against God, God sent fiery serpents, they bit the people, but God sent an answer to. With me? He said, yes, you're under a curse, you've been punished for what you've done. He said, but I'm going to make a way of escape for you. You with me? And he said, put that fiery bronze serpent on that pole and lift it up high for everybody that is hurting or bit, and they could look up and see it. But it wasn't just looking at a serpent. It wasn't just you're laying there, you're bitten, because there's some stubborn people in Pueblo, in Israel. I ain't looking at no stupid serpent. Why would I look at a stupid serpent? That's dumb. Remember today I told you better listen to the preacher. He said, look at the serpent on the pole. Look up and God will heal you. Man, I heard that for you. They'll die. All dead from a snake bite because they failed to look on that serpent because they were so stubborn. But many of the people of Israel looked. And it wasn't just a look, a glance, just save us, so we don't die. It was believing in that serpent, believing and trusting. And that's where he used the scripture. He said, as Moses lifted that serpent up, so must Jesus be lifted up on that cross, that whoever believes, whoever looks on him for salvation, amen, would not perish, but have everlasting life. You with me? Jesus is the reversal of the curse. He's the one that can break it. No matter what you're in, even today. Now listen, this is important not just for you, but for your families. Amen. You've got to realize God is raising you up to be a spokesman for Him. Amen. You with me? And when and whoever believes in Jesus, whoever has faith in Him, whoever accepts Him as their Lord and Savior, He said, I don't care what curses come upon you. I don't care if you're dying of AIDS and we've seen them healed. I don't care if you're fighting cancer. I don't care what you're going through. If you look on Me, I'll reverse that curse. No matter why you're sick or what you're going through, I'll reverse the curse. I'll heal your body. You with me? That's the power of God. That's the power of the gospel.
Amen.
That God is able to reverse the curse. That you with me?
Amen.
That Jesus, I remember I told you the Old Testament was a picture of what Jesus was going to do. It was always pointing to Christ.
Yeah.
Even when Adam and Eve sinned and they were cursed and thrown out of the garden, God slew a lamb. He put the clothes on him. It said that you're going to be cursed and you're going to work with the sweat of your brow. Woman, He said, because you've given, you've eaten of that apple I told you, or the fruit I told you not to, in childbearing, you're going to feel that pain in your body.
Right.
And He told that serpent, He said, and you're cursed. I believe that, that snakes used to have legs. And I seen a special one time where it said that the snakes, these certain snakes, they would take them and they would search them out. You know how they do the open them up and do all that? And there was places inside where there was legs before, and there's not legs now. And I believe that happened in Genesis. You with me? Chapter 3. That God said, because of what you did, now you're going to slither and you're going to suck dirt for the rest of your days. I believe that thing's legs came right off of him. You with me? And He said this, He said of Christ, even back then, He said, you will bruise His heel, but He will crush your head. Speaking of who? Who's He? Jesus. Way back in Genesis, in the beginning, God had already made plans to crush the enemy underfoot.
Amen.
He's seen the cross 2,000 years later, or 4,000 years later, He's seen the cross.
Amen.
And He said, and when Jesus was bruised, it said it'll bruise His heel. On the cross, they used to have a little post that the people would stand on, and their heels would be placed on it, and all the weight of their body. Could you imagine all the weight? It doesn't even matter how much you weigh, if you're heavy or not. All the weight of your body on your heel for hours and hours and hours. That's going to hurt. And every time it hurt so bad, that you with me? They would fall and it would hurt, but they were lifting themselves up, because when they hung and they would let go, they would suffocate from their lungs. So they would push up on that board so that they could breathe again, and their heels were bruised. until they could not do it anymore and finally hung and died of suffocation from their lungs. He said, you'll bruise his heel, but he's going to crush your head. And I don't know about you, but what would be worse, a bruised heel or your head completely injured, you with me, beyond repair? A head trauma is heavy duty. You can always, you know, get one of those skates, you know, them things, have you seen them?
Yeah.
People put their knee in their shh, shh. You can always get one of those, but you can't fix the head when it's crushed. It is what it is, right? That's what your shirt says, right? Is that the shirt? It is what it is. Oh, it's the great I am. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so, just like that, must Jesus be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, be cast off or sent to hell, but have eternal life. And that's what it's about. Amen. Jesus was the fiery serpent in the desert. Jesus will reverse the curse. I want to show you this King Hezekiah in 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 1 through 6. This is about King Hezekiah, who God spoke to him, sent the prophet of God to speak to him and tell him, Hezekiah, you's going to die. You's going to die. And even when God speaks a word, you with me? Watch and see how God will turn. He'll change his mind.
Yeah.
Hmm? Yeah. You with me? Yeah. There's some people out there messed up. They're all jacked up. Because, you know, really, in all reality, because of the way they live their lives and stuff, they're under a curse. You with me? They're under a curse from God because they, you know, he said, if you go on, John 3:16, that he loved us so much, sent his son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He said, for God sent his son into the world, not to condemn the world, but to save the world. This is the condemnation. This is where you're judged and condemned already. He says that light came into the world and men, people love to live in darkness more than they love to live for the Lord. And that's the reason they're under a curse. That's the reason they're under this condemnation, even living, right? Yeah. You ever heard the phrase dead man walking?
Yeah.
Those of you who've been in you've heard this in the prison and different stuff, or a death row, dead man walking, them were the men that were going to the death, to the gas chamber or whatever it was to be killed. You with me? They were alive, but they're dead men walking. That's the way it is when you're not living for the Lord. You're just living a dead life. You're just like Bernie, man. We can't have Bernie's. You ever seen that?
Yeah.
Huh? People are carrying you around. You got your shades on and your fashion designer jeans and all that. And you're just, you know, you're just drinking and you're just smoking and shooting dope and laying down with people and all this stuff. Really, you're just all dead.
Yeah.
You with me? There's no spirit, there's no life inside of you without Christ. He said, men, this is the condemnation that men love darkness more than light. You with me?
Yeah.
And people living under that curse. But I'm telling you today, he reversed a little bit, and it says Jesus overcame that. As Moses lifted up the serpent, so must the Son of God be lifted up, and whoever believes in him would not perish. You with me?
Yeah.
But have everlasting life. God will reverse your curse. God will you with me? You see these family members and these people and these friends and all these people. You've got to be the one to tell them, listen, I know what you're going through. I know what you're under and all this. All you've got to do is surrender to God.
Yeah.
That's all you got to do. I've seen them in their deathbed. I've seen them make a choice to die.
Yeah.
Some have chased us out of their deathbed room. Get out of here, I don't want to hear it. And died right there. And it's like, God, have mercy on their souls.
Right, amen.
Refusing to look on that. Because it said many of Israel, they turned and looked at the serpent, but there was a lot that didn't. There'll be a lot of people who won't believe our report, won't believe what we say. They'd rather die in their sin. One man who was an old Catholic man, God spoke to me like that, Jen. He told me, go pray for that man and I'm going to heal him. And I told him that. And he told me, you can't read your Bible. That's not for us. That's for the fathers.
Yeah.
That's for the priest. You can't do that. And I said, sir, listen, I forget all that. I said, God sent me over here, told me if I pray for you, he's going to heal you. That old man said, you get out of here. I don't want nothing with your God or this and that. And I'm like, sir, you do not understand. God wants to heal you right now. He was old. He had arthritis. And he was all crippled up. And I said, God will heal you. He said, I don't want nothing to do with you or your God. Get out of my property. And you know what I mean? And to know that God would reverse that curse right there.
That's right.
To know, like you said, Jen, that God was going to touch him. You could see it. You knew it.
Yeah.
And he rejected you and your God because of what? Religion? Because of what I've always been taught all my life? Because of what grandma said and mama said and daddy said?
Yeah.
Is it possible that grandma could have been wrong?
Yeah.
Is it possible that daddy and mama and all the rest, they could have been wrong, that they really didn't understand who God was? It was just a form of godliness, but denying the power to change you?
Yeah.
Could be. Could be I'm wrong, but I think I'm right.
Amen.
Let's look at Hezekiah here. Second Kings chapter 20, verse 1 through 6. Now listen. When we read this and when we see this, get it in your spirit so you can preach to your family.
Amen.
Some of them are on death row right now, not in a prison, but in their home.
Right.
Some are sick and they're dying right in front of you. You've got to have an answer. You've got to have a word for them.
Amen.
2 Kings 20, verse 1 through 6 says, in those days, Hezekiah was sick. Amen. Do you know anybody that's sick and near death? He said, in Isaiah, the prophet, Pastor Vince said to him, the son of Amos, he said, went to him, and he said to him, thus says the Lord, he says, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live. That's not a good testimony. That's not a good word to give.
Yeah.
You with me? And believe me when I tell you that God has used me in certain areas. And I remember my friend Barney. I spoke to my friend Barney before he died. And I remember the Lord told me, he says, you go tell Barney to repent. You tell Barney, give his life to me and I'll save him. And listen, and I told him exactly. I said, Barney, God told me. He said, you need to give your life to him. You need to repent, give your life to Jesus, and God will save you. I said, but if you don't, the same way that you killed that man at the flying eye is the same way that you will die. As the sun rises up in the morning, I said, so will the sun rise on that day when your dead body lies in front of that. You with me? In front of your family, and you flatline, and he's like, so be it. So be it. Is what he said. So be it. You know what that means in our language?
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
So be it unto me according to thy word. And it wasn't just a few days later that I got the call. It says, Barney's in the hospital, been shot. And I went in and sat with him as he's dying in that bed, praying for him, crying for him, speaking to him. And Barney, give your life to Jesus. You know, they say the last thing to go is your hearing. And so I'm crying for him, I'm praying for him, I'm sitting on the floor, just sitting there praying for my friend, and I noticed the sun's rising up as the doctor pronounced him dead. And he said, and the Lord spoke to me, he said, son, did you not warn him? God is good,
wow.
And God will warn you.
That's right.
And God will give you a chance.
That's right.
You with me?
Yeah.
And as that sun rose up, that he flatlined and pronounced him dead. And God says, look, where's the bad boy now? Where's the lover?
Mm-hmm.
Had all the ladies.
Mm-hmm.
Where is he now? Like his carcass is lying there dead on that table. You with me? And believe me when I tell you, I've been at these places and God has used me to speak in people's lives that were near death, and some turned it around for God.
Amen.
And some have died and went into eternity without God. God brought a prophet of God. God brought a preacher and he spoke to him. And he said, thus says the Lord, set your house in order, for you shall die and not live. Now watch this. Then Hezekiah turned face towards the wall and prayed to the Lord, saying, remember now, O Lord, I pray, how I have walked before you. Now listen, this was a man of God. This was a king. This was a guy who feared the Lord. You with me?
Yeah.
See, listen to his prayer. He's telling him, hey, listen, pastor told us, and we did this, and the word of God said, and I came to prayer, and I stood in the gap, and I have something to hold on to now.
Amen.
He ain't bankrupt. He ain't like some of us go to the bank trying to write a check and get in trouble.
Yeah.
You with me? He had more than enough. He had served the Lord all his life. He was living for Jesus, and he turned to the world and said, God, I know you spoke this word, but oh God, I don't want to die.
Amen.
Remember me, God. I served you. Remember how I prayed and I fasted. Remember how I witnessed and I was a pillar in my church. Remember these things, oh God.
Amen.
Hmm? How I have walked before you in truth. Amen. And with a loyal heart. I was faithful to you, God. And have done what was good in your sight. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. You with me?
Amen.
And it happened before Isaiah had gone out into the middle courts, that the word of the Lord came to him saying, return and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people. He says this, thus says the Lord. Now listen, Isaiah had given him a word and said, hey, bud, you better get your house in order, for you're about to die. And he gave his word and he walked out. And just for a moment, and at moment's notice, he turned and he wept. Hezekiah wept and Isaiah was walking out. He had told him what God said. And as he's walking towards the door, getting ready to leave, God said, stop, Hezekiah, or Isaiah, turn around and go speak another word to him. Because I seen his heart change. Something inside. See, there's something inside of our hearts. There's something inside of their hearts that must change. It's called repentance. You with me? Turning back, turning away from our sin. Saying, God, I'm sorry, please forgive me. God is a merciful God. God don't send anybody to hell.
Amen.
If people go to hell, it's because they chose to go to hell. And they chose not to live for the Lord, but to live for themselves and the pleasure of life. As he was reaching the middle court, the word of God came to him. He says, I have heard your prayers, and I have seen your tears. You think God don't hear and see? Surely I will heal you. On the third day, you shall go up to the house of the Lord. Now he didn't say go to the mall. He didn't say on the third day you're going to go to work.
Yeah.
Come on now. He said on the third day, you shall go up to church. To the house of the Lord, and I will add to you, to your days, 15 years.
Wow.
He said, I will deliver you and this city. Now listen, I will deliver not only you, but Pueblo too.
Yeah.
From the hand of the king of Assyria, or you could say from the hand of the devil. Wow. And I will defend the city for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David.
Amen.
The Lord spoke.
Amen.
Huh? God's not only concerned about you, he loves those people out there. He loves those co-workers that you work with. He loves those people, you with me, that are neighbors. He loves the, you know, and your family members. He loves them. You with me? And you got to understand, you keeping close to God and you turning to God, no matter what situation it is, even if you find yourself sick, turn to God and tell him, God, I'm not ready to die yet. I want to live, Lord. I want to live. Why should I give you life? Why do you want to live so you can go, you know, do all your fun things? Or are you willing to lay your life down for me? I really believe it. One man said this. He said, when I was testifying one night, he jumped up in the middle of my service and he said, my brother was shot in the face with a shotgun like you. He said, I wish it was you that died and not him. Why did God let you live? And he runs out. All this crowd of youth and everybody standing there. And I'm like, I mean, you feel kind of stupid in that situation.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
But I said, you know why God saved me? You know why I live today? I said, because God knew that I'd be speaking to you tonight. God knew that I'd be telling you to serve Jesus, that I'd be telling you there is no other way. You must turn to God with all your heart. I said, that's why God saved me and maybe not your brother. I don't know why. I said, but God knew that I would preach the gospel. You with me? I knew that God didn't save me and do all these marvelous things so I could come, you know, and attend services. You with me? Or put my Bible in my car or listen to Q102 Christian radio station. That's why he saved me. Now he saved me to set the captives free. He saved me to open blind eyes, to set, you with me? To loose the oppressed, to preach the gospel to the poor. That's why he saved me. And that's why he saved you too. Amen. That was it. Come on now. Huh? The Bible says that God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humble or humility will get God's attention on your behalf. God doesn't like proud people. God likes humble people. God likes people that will bow a knee. People that will say, I can't do it. I can't do it no more. Please, Lord, help me. That's when God, you got God's attention. A broken heart, a broken spirit, a contrite heart, where you're saying, God, I can't do this. I've tried everything. I don't know what to do. And you fall flat on your face and say, Lord, Jesus, take the wheel. That's when God swoops in. That's when God comes to the rescue. Amen, Pastor. I want to show you a wicked king. I want to show you an evil king. Remember the other day, well, it's been a few months, I preached on Jezebel. I talked about Jezebel, and I talked about her king, her husband Ahab. And Ahab went out and threw his little pity party fit because he couldn't buy the vineyard next door. Because he wanted a vineyard, and I want it now. And he threw his fit and did all this, and he went home. He got into bed, and he started crying. And his wife said, what are you doing, king? What's wrong with you? That's not fit for a king to act like that little child. This guy wouldn't sell me his vineyard, and I want his vineyard. And he said he could give me the other one, but it's too far. I want this one. And his wife said, it's not right for you to be a king and act like this. She said, let me deal with this man. And that murderer Jezebel went out and slew this man, killed him, and gave her husband the vineyard. You with me? And so all this stuff happens, you know what I mean? They set it up, they kill this man, she gives him the vineyard, and all this stuff, but then God sees. How many know God sees everything? God sees. And in let's see where I'm at here. Let me give you the scripture so you can, let's see. 1 Kings chapter 21, we're starting in verse 17, going down to verse 29. 1 Kings 21, starting at 17. There's a couple of verses in there I missed because it says just talks about Jezebel, and I didn't want to give her the time of day. Amen. Evil King Ahab repents. Amen. Verse 17. Then the word of the Lord, now this is after him and his wife killed that man and all this stuff. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king of Israel. Now this was one of God's kings that was acting this way, who lives in Samaria. There he is in the vineyard of Naboth. Remember the vineyard he stole, killed the man? He's in the vineyard. He says, where he has gone down to take possession of the vineyard, you shall speak to him, saying, thus says the Lord. I wish there was more prophets and more preachers who would say that. Who would be in so contact with God, he would speak to you, and you would be telling some of your family, thus says the Lord, if you don't repent. You with me? Yeah. If you don't repent, you with me? Yeah. You only have so much time. Yeah. Thus says the Lord, he said, have you murdered and also taken possession? And you shall speak to him, saying, Thus says the Lord, in the place where dogs licked the blood of Naboth, dogs shall lick your blood, even yours. So now, are you with me? Do you understand what he's saying? The way you were murdered, God said, I'm going to kill you. And them dogs are going to lick your blood from that floor. And Ahab, listen what Ahab does. So Ahab said to Elisha, have you found me, O my enemy? And he answered, I have found you, because you have sold yourself to do evil in the sight of the Lord. Behold, I will bring calamity on you. I will take away your posterity and will cut off from Ahab every male in Israel, both bond and free. Amen. God's bringing judgment on Ahab because he sinned. Because he did, he said, has you found me? Hast thou found me? Remember, who seen Ahab in the vineyard? Huh? It was the Lord. Remember, just a few verses ago. God seen Ahab in the vineyard of Naboth. And he sees us today. Everything we do. There's nothing secret in God's eyes. I saw, what is it today? I said, you can shut them lights off. No matter what happens in darkness, God sees it as bright as day.
Right.
Hast thou found me? Have you found my sin now? That's what he was saying. That's heavy. Have you found my sin? He said, I found you, my enemy. Huh? He was an enemy of Elijah. He was an enemy of God. And a lot of people don't understand that. You with me? That they're enemies of the Lord. They're not enemies of the church or this and that. That, you know, I am a friend of God. He said, if you're a friend of this world, you're an enemy of God. You with me? And Ahab had sinned. Ahab had done some bad stuff. But that's not what I want to focus on. Not that he sinned. Not even that he murdered somebody. You with me? But, amen. I think it was, where did I say, verse... I don't know where I'm at. You find it there. It says, but there was no one like Ahab who sold himself to do wickedness in the sight of the Lord. Amen? In other words, there was nobody as bad as Ahab who done so much wicked in the sight of God because Jezebel, his wife, stirred him up. Uh-oh. That Jezebel, man. She stirred that man to do evil, amen? It says, and he behaved very abominably in following idols according to all that the Ammonites had done. When the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. God didn't want the idols. God cast all that stuff out. Ahab brought them all back in. So it was that when Ahab heard these words, or those words, watch this, this is where it turns, that he tore his clothes and he put sackcloth on his body and fasted and lay in sackcloth and went about mourning. Amen. Amen. Even the wickedest person turned to God. The most wicked man, murderer, dogs licking his enemy's blood, taking possessions of vineyards and doing more idol worship than any other king, humbled himself. I told you, when you humble yourself, God comes close. No matter who you are, you could be the worst of the worst. Ahab, they said there was no man as bad as Ahab. And Ahab humbled himself in God's sight. Amen?
Amen.
And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, see how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself before me, he says, I will not bring the calamity in his days. In the day of his sons, I will bring the calamity on his house. because he was willing to humble himself, God said, I'm not going to bring calamity on Ahab. Now understand, it's hard to comprehend this, but understand that sometimes our sin brings calamity even on our families and our children. You with me? And the things that we're unwilling to deal with, God, you know, God forgives. God forgave David. David sinned with Bathsheba. Baby was conceived. He murdered her husband. All this bad stuff. But he repented. He you know what I mean? And God said, well, it's going to cost something. And it cost David his own son, that baby in Bathsheba's womb. It cost the life of that son. But he said this also. He said, you know what? I'm not going to take the kingdom from you. I'm not going to bring judgment on you and this and that. He said, but the sword will never depart from your sons. You with me? Absalom, his son with the long hair, tried to take his kingdom by force, was caught in the hair trying to kill his own father with his hair hanging there until they shot him with arrows. You with me? One of his other sons raped his daughter. One of his other boys killed him for raping her. You know what I mean? And it was like things happened. You know what I mean? And it was like, man, there was a curse in their family.
Yeah.
But understand again, this is the Old Testament. You with me?
Yeah.
Jesus can reverse the curse.
Amen.
No matter what has affected you, no matter what has come against your family, Jesus can not only, you know what I mean, reverse it, but break it off your family.
Amen.
He said this, he said, if you sin against me, he said, the sins of the father will reach to, I think he said, 7 or 8 generations. He said, that's how long you're going to deal with it because you've sinned. He said, but if you turn to me, I will bless you and your descendants to 1,000 generations.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. Amen. Think about that. It doesn't even make sense.
Amen.
A few generations or 1,000, a blessing. You with me?
Amen.
And you know what I mean? And that's why we're to serve the Lord with all our heart. It's because we want not only us, but our family and our children and grandchildren blessed. Because of decisions we made.
Amen.
Break the curse.
Amen.
Jesus will reverse that curse in your life, no matter what it is. Even if you've done wrong, even if you're the most wicked person there is, he said, if you humble yourself, he said, I'll reverse that curse. I'll take it off your life.
Amen.
I'll heal your body.
Amen.
I'll save your soul.
Amen.
I'll give you peace.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
He said, if we would only humble ourselves, that's what I said, if we would only humble ourselves and turn or look to Jesus, he would reverse the curse, amen, and heal us. 1 John 3:8 said this, for this purpose was the Son of God manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's why Jesus came. You with me? You understand that every sin and every curse and every disease, every STD, AIDS, anything you could think of was thrown on him. Cancer, diabetes, arthritis, everything was, could you imagine what he looked like? He wasn't some beautiful Savior all built and on the cross with a little blood here and, you know, and all six-packed. The Bible says in Isaiah that you could not recognize who he was. That's how bad. You got to realize he went before the Sanhedrin, over 200 of these Sanhedrin, and every single one of them. And I was watching a show the other day. I don't know what the show was, but these were like some POWs that were taken. You know what I mean, into captivity, and this man had to be beaten. His friends had to punch him in the face so the Japanese wouldn't kill him, and they had punched him. Over 200 men would punch him hard in the face, and I mean, he was just bloody and battered, but he took it, and I'm all, wow. Could you imagine what Jesus went through? Over 200 men with all their might just slapped him as hard as they could. His face wasn't pretty. You couldn't even recognize this man. Bent over a pole with 39 lashes on his body with razors and rocks and you know what I mean? That would rip the flesh right off his body. Could you imagine laying on that? All your organs exposed. beaten with 3-4 inch thorns and you pushed inside your skull on that cross, pierced your hands and your feet. You with me? Pierced his side with the sword and blood and water flowed. So that you, he said, and by his stripes, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, because of our sin. He was bruised. And you know what the bruising is? It's bleeding inside. Yeah, our teenagers, our children, family members are bleeding inside.
Right.
You with me?
Right.
The cutters, they're cutting themselves because they said it releases the pain from their bodies. And he says, you with me? He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. That's Jesus. That's the gospel. Because he was on that cross, he took away every pain, every disease, every shameful thing, every sin. And not only did he die for us, the Bible says he went to hell for 3 days. You with me?
Right.
He went to hell for us so we don't have to go there. Anybody say, God won't send you to hell and this and that. He sent his own son so that you could get out. You with me? And all that stuff that he went through. And you with me? Satan was rejoicing, man. He thought he won the victory. I killed the Son of God.
Yeah.
But he didn't know. See, that was Friday. He didn't know Sunday's coming. He didn't know that morning when the ground shook. You with me? And the stone was rolled away and Jesus appears in glorious white raiment. He freaked. I think he's still hiding to this day. Because he didn't know what to do. He didn't know how to handle it. He was defeated. God conquered death, hell, and the grave. Came with keys. You with me? Have you ever lost your keys or been locked out of your car or house? You know, man, them keys are important. Jesus came with the keys of death, hell, and the grave in his hand. You with me? So you guys don't have to worry no more. Every sickness, every disease, everything. If you believe in me, if you serve me, if you come out to me, he said, I'll heal you. I'll deliver you. I've broken the curse. All you've got to do is accept it. All you've got to do is believe in me. You with me?
Yeah.
There's no sickness on earth that is more powerful than the name of Jesus.
Right.
Not even death itself, you with me, has more power than Jesus.
Amen.
He can raise people from the dead. He can do whatever he wants to do.
Right.
You with me? Because he's God.
Amen.
What the devil meant for evil, he'll turn it around for your good.
Yeah.
He'll turn it for your good.
Yeah.
Huh? The worst of the worst, he'll turn for you. All you got to do is believe. That's it. Simple.
Wow.
Believe in Jesus. Believe. Give him your heart. Give him everything you are. Look to him. Don't be stubborn tonight.
Amen.
Look to Jesus. Look to him and cry out to him. Come, God, I can't do it by myself. I need you, but give him your life.
Amen.
You with me?
Amen.
Give him your future. Give him your everything. You can't do it. You know what religion is? It's a failed part of man to try and reach God and do good enough. You know what I mean? Christianity is a God that loved you so much. He's looking down and he did all the work for you.
Amen.
He did everything. You don't have to do nothing. Just accept him and believe in him. Give him everything. That's all you got to do.
Amen.
It's so simple. It's hard, I guess. You with me? All I can tell you is that when I was on my deathbed, my girlfriend wasn't there. Not even my kids were there. My mom was, you know, trying to do her best. What can a mom do for you? Cry for you? You with me? But the power of God that came in my room that day, that changed my life, that saved me, that healed me. You with me? Something that I'll never forget. I didn't forget about it. I remember what God has done. You with me?
Amen.
I said, God, my life is in your hand. I didn't say, I promise from now on, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to go to church on Sunday, Lord. I promise and fail at my promise. You with me? I didn't say, you know what I mean? I knew from that moment on my life was changed. I'll never be the same. I'm a preacher from this point on.
Yeah.
I didn't, I didn't just think about it and say, hey, this sounds like fun. Let's be a preacher and have everybody mad at you. You with me? Have everybody upset and offended at you because you're telling them the truth or you're telling them the way and who are you, you know, and all this stuff. Huh? I didn't want that. But I said, God, my life is in your hands. He told me who I was. He told me, you're going to preach the gospel, son. There I am, a blind cholo. You with me? Full of holes in my head and face and missing teeth and everything else, all messed up. And God says, son, you're going to preach my gospel. I'm going to raise you up, and people are going to hear about how good I am. And that's what I've been doing ever since. I didn't join a church or a religion and, you know what I mean, and say, you know, I think I'm going to start going here or do that. I got saved. I gave God my life. I laid it down that day. You know, I ought to have shirts made in remembrance of Vince Diaz, who died November 23rd, 1985. Huh? Yeah, we remember remember the new man. A new man was raised that day. A new man lives for God. A new man preaches the gospel. You with me? And many lives are touched. Many who believe were saved. Many who believed in his Lord and in his Savior were saved.
Amen.
God reversed the curse in my life. I was a messed up homeboy. I was abusive to my girlfriend. I was neglectful of my children. I was a drunk. I was a drug user. I was all jacked up, and I was mad at everybody, and I'd fight everybody at the drop of a hat. I was just so miserable until I met Jesus. Huh? Until he turned my life around. He reversed everything the devil meant for evil. You with me? My daddy died when I was 4 months old in a car wreck, drunk, going to another bar. You with me? That's what the devil wanted to do for me.
Right.
He wanted to kill me like he killed my father. Come on, somebody. Right. Like my uncles and those who died of overdoses or cirrhosis or of all this. He wanted to kill me the same way.
Right.
You with me?
Yeah.
But God saved my life.
Right.
You with me?
Amen.
And that enemy has tried to kill my children.
Yeah.
He knows he can't kill me, but he's going to try and kill my kids.
Right.
He's tried. You with me? Amen?
Amen?
But I rebuke the devil tonight in Jesus' name. What the devil means for evil, God's going to turn it for our good. God will have his way. I don't care. My wife said, I don't care. My son goes in with one eye, no teeth, one leg into heaven. You know what I mean? He said, he's going to walk in those
perfect days.
He's going to fulfill his purpose on this earth. God's going to use him. He's going to stand right here by his daddy one day. I've told you that. He's going to stand, maybe even take that pulpit. He can have it. Preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And tell him what God did for him. See, because if you've never been to hell, you can't tell somebody how God brought you out. You can't, with passion and with power, you can't tell them where you've never been before.
Right.
But he's a man, even Ahab was the most wicked man, and God turned him around because Ahab humbled himself. That's where it starts, that's where it begins, that's where it ends, in humility before God. Every day, God, I need you. I can't make it without you. It's my prayer every day, not back in 1985, every day, God, to be a good husband, to be a good father, to be a grandfather to my children, to be a good pastor, a good man of God who touches people all over for you, God. Every day, God, help me, Jesus. It's not just some religious, pious person who goes to church and wants to be seen by everybody else. That man, you'll never know how far he can bring you unless you've been to the hell itself. Until you realize and understand, man, only God did this for me. It wasn't religion, it wasn't a church, it wasn't a pastor. It was God who met me there in my deathbed, who brought me out when I couldn't even see. I'm blinded by all the sin and the junk. The devil wanted to destroy me, and he did. You with me?
Yeah.
But God had a different plan. God said, I said, God, open my eyes so I could read your word. You heard me read all kinds of scripture. I might not be quick. I might not be like other pastors or this and that, but I got a message that'll change your life. You'll never know how far God can reach. That's why I have hope for these people. If God did it for me, I know he can do it for my son. If God did it for me, I know he can do it for your husband or your son or your whoever you are. He did it for my wife. He can do it for you. Any teenage mother, any of you, God can reach and he can do it. Because he's a God that can turn things around. The devil wants to destroy you. The devil hates you. And he ain't happy until you and your children, your family are in a box. But God came that you might have life and have it happy, abundant, overflowing life. Amen. That you would live. You with me? Amen. And that's what God's purpose is tonight. Amen. What the devil meant for evil, Joseph said. I read it before service. What you meant for evil, he said to his brothers. Amen. He said, God used it for my good. God turned it not only for my good, but for the good of the nation of Israel.
Amen.
You with me? See, God's, he don't want to just stop with you. He wants to save a whole bunch of them. And what God did for my life, he don't want to just save my family. He wants, he ain't done, he ain't happy until all Pueblo saved.
Amen.
He ain't happy until Colorado turns from their weed and their dope and turns to Christ for hope.
Amen.
You with me?
Yep.
He ain't happy until this nation turns back to God. You with me? Till we forget all this other stuff and we turn back to God. We are a Christian nation. We were founded as a Christian nation. We will be a Christian nation in the end. No matter what man says, no matter what any president says, this nation will be a Christian nation once again. And this world's had a duty and it needs the Lord. It needs missionaries. It needs pastors. It needs preachers. This nation needs prophets. This world needs people that will share their faith. You with me? That will allow God to call. Because see, God's always calling. You with me? The day I got saved is the day I knew God's call. I didn't go to church for 30 years, and then one day, you know, this voice from heaven opened up, and I seen God, and he said, Vince, today I want to use you. Please let me. The day I got saved and gave Jesus my life, that's when God spoke to me and said, son, you're going to preach the gospel. It doesn't take 30 years. It doesn't take 20 years. It doesn't take 10 years. It takes a person that is in service, that is in church, that has a hunger for God. Say, God, use me. God, come on, somebody. You ever heard the phrase, you're the only Jesus they're ever going to see? What if it's you? What if you're the one to go out there and save that soul? Yet we went somewhere else. Did something else, said, oh, that's not for me. You with me?
Good.
It is for you. It is for everyone who believes in Jesus Christ. You can make a difference in the lives of somebody else. All you got to do is be willing. All you got to do is be obedient to the Lord. You with me?
Yep.
Give him everything. Give him your whole life.
Amen.
You with me? You can't change the past. I tell them kids, I tell the youth, the people I talk to in prisons, whatever, you can never change your past, but you can change your future.
Amen.
You can't go backwards the last 10 years in church or whatever, but you can start from tonight.
Amen.
You can give God everything tonight. Amen. Tell him, God, I don't even know where to start. I don't even know where to begin. That's good, because then it would be you doing it. God likes people. You know what I mean? He likes people who are just like blank sheets, so he can begin to write a verse, write a psalm, you with me? Write your story. You with me? Now, well, I think, and all this other stuff, you know? It's like God don't need your opinions, you know? He has enough already. What he needs is just simple. Read it and obey it.
Amen.
I read it and obey it. Read the red, pray for the power. That's it.
Amen.
That's what God needs. Amen. Amen. Stand with me tonight.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.